resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth. This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D. Squared. Let me lay out the show for you real quick. We just have one guest tonight. You know, we blew our wad on the Halloween spooktacular. Tonight we just have Jeremy Piven. If you don't recognize that name, shame on you. But he was Ari Gold from Entourage. He was Draws in PCU. I don't know what character he played in Judgment Night, but that was the best soundtrack on the face of the planet. I digress. But Jeremy Piven will join us around 7:30 tonight. We'll talk with him about his new movie, My Dad's Christmas Date. I got an advanced screener of it. It was cute. It's not your typical Christmas fluff. It wasn't a Hallmark movie. They had feels, and I was angry because I don't like feels. But Jeremy Piven, as our guest, we'll talk to him around 7:30. But we've got a lot of stuff to do for our top nerd news tonight. So you know what? Without much further ado, let's jump right into our top nerd news. And now, your top nerd news stories from around the world, brought to you by the Viridian Tea Company. Find them on Etsy. And now, your top nerd news stories. The Mandalorian Season 2, Episode 2, came out on Friday. And if you follow them on Twitter, they'll tweet at you to remind you. Ooh. And it comes out at 2 a.m. on Fridays. So it's... I had to go to bed because I have to work. But I did watch it last night, Skungy. And... let's do this real quick because we're going to talk about the premiere. Spoiler alerts. Spoiler alerts. We're going to talk about episode one of season two. We're not going to talk about episode two because there were spiders and Scungy's terrified of spiders. So let's talk about Mando episode one, season two. One of the things that I really want to talk about this is because there's some people... won't let us have anything nice. And over there at cosmicbooknews.com, and the guy, Doomcock is his name. He looks like, I don't know, like if you ordered a Dr. Doom costume on Wish, that's what you would get.
So true.
But these are, by definition, and I hate some of these buzzwords that happen around, but they are part of the toxic fandom. In essence, they said that the Mandalorian episode, the premiere, was a failure. And what's interesting, Skungy, on our Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeekRadioShow, some people were like, yeah, well, you know, there were mitigating circumstances. And one thing that I thought held some a grain of truth is that was when Hurricane Zeta blew through and knocked out everybody's power for 5 days or more. You and I were – I left the station Sunday night, still had no power. I got it back about 10 o'clock on Sunday night. That sucked. But there were sweeping winds all across the southern states, Gulf South, you know, just bam, you knocked out a lot of power. That's a big chunk. I mean, so it makes a little sense that maybe the numbers would be down for that. But honestly, everyone has been looking forward to The Mandalorian because, you know, your boy Jinjin Darin is basically, he's got a broken back from carrying the entire Disney franchise right now. But these guys really were just saying that, oh, it's because of the feminist agenda pushed forward by Kathleen Kennedy. And nobody wants to watch this stuff because Cara Dune is, you know, angry and just all these weird things. Where they just want to crap on everything, and I just don't get it, and it makes me mad because there are reasons to hate the final trilogy, the end of the Skywalker saga. You know, there were valid reasons sucking on, you know, space cows' boobies for blue milk. It's huge. That's a deal breaker for me. But these are kind of like the guys who really kind of just attack the fandom just because.
it seems like they don't want anybody to enjoy something. So if there's a part of the show that they don't like, mm-hmm. be it something small, be it, hey, this episode, the first episode didn't start off with that bang that the first season did. And it seems like, I mean, you're in the second act of it. So things go a little bit slower to
and
build up.
But it sort of did. They held true because it opens up with two Gamorreans having a death match.
It was so cool.
It really was. I mean, look, this season, and let me do it again. Spoiler alerts. Season 2, episode 1 of The Mandalorian. Spoiler alerts. Because they brought in Boba Fett's armor, Timothy Oliphant playing the marshal. I forgot his name. Because look, I've been reading the Aftermath series by Chuck Wendig, which is the three books that pick up immediately after the end of Return of the Jedi, where people are destroying the Emperor's statue in Coruscant, and they start getting the snot shot out of them by the Imperial authorities. And they go through there, but these cool little vignettes throughout the book, which introduced me to that character. So when he came on the screen, I was like, there he is. Because I've read about him in some of the books. He's a minor character. It's really literally just little tiny vignettes, like a quarter of a chapter long. But it said, you know, how he got the Jawas, you know, got the armor and stuff. And the thing is that at the end of the episode, I was kind of confused as to who that was, because when the Mandalorian gets the armor, they kill the crate dragon, and he's riding off in the sunset, you see, the guy who plays all of the clones, you know, Jango Fett, etc., watching him drive off.
Yeah.
And immediately my kid's like, there's Boba Fett. And I'm like, yeah, maybe.
Well, who do you think it is?
I think it might be Captain Rex.
No way.
Well, so look, just hear me out. Because we already know, and this kind of rolls into one of our other topics, how Apple has somehow, you know, spoiled the surprise oh my God, I'm blanking. Rosario Dawson is going to be Ahsoka Tano, because they said, he's going to be playing alongside, talking about Jin Jin Darin, alongside Timothy Oliphant and Rosario Dawson as Ahsoka Tano. Well, it's never been confirmed yet, but Apple went and screwed it up.
Of course.
But the reason I'd been seeing other things about Rex and Ahsoka Tano showing up, and when I saw that, I immediately thought of clones, just because you don't think of him as Boba Fett, though,
yeah.
Okay? And that we all understand that he was an unaltered clone who grew naturally, and in the Mandalorian series, he will be 41 years old, so he looked a little old. He had scars on his face, because if you get eaten by a Sarlacc, it's not going to end well for you. But I think it's the low-hanging fruit to assume that it's Boba Fett, and that's why I'm thinking it might be either another clone or Captain Rex. Well, you keep shaking
There's
your head
no
at
way.
Me. What?
There's no way.
Why?
It could be. Okay, because we find out in the Rebels show, which is canon, you find out that Rex is still around,
okay.
But the clones have been aged unnaturally. So Rex is much, much older, 5 years before the events of Rebels.
Oh, light bulb.
So he is, like, Rex looks like a 60-year-old man. Like, Rex and Wolf and the rest of
right.
the clones all look like they're in their 60s.
Right, because they advanced their age so that they could immediately go to war.
Yep.
Wow. All right,
yeah.
Brilliant. Okay.
So it's got to be Boba Fett. I mean, Who else? You've
definitely earned your food tonight. I'm
but
feed
who else?
You tonight.
Who else would it be? Honestly, I mean,
well, I thought it could be one of the other clones, because I mean, honestly, you know, I mean, yeah, sure, it's there in front of your face.
Yeah.
It's the Boba Fett armor flying away on a speeder with Jin Jin Darin. But it was funny because I guess because I'd been assimilating so much information about the Mandalorian series and all the stuff that's going on, that I was like, is it really Boba? And, you know, we've heard that Boba Fett's coming, but, you know, when you see Timothy Oliphant step onto the screen, and I go back to the whole wish analogy, it's like, it's perfect, the meme of how I thought I would look, and then you see the picture of Timothy Oliphant and the Mandalorian in Boba Fett's armor, it's like, looks a little scrawny, huh?
Yeah, it didn't look.
Aren't you a little short to be a stormtrooper?
It was a little underwhelming at that point.
It
You're
was
because
he looked a bit like a scarecrow. The helmet was too big, but you know the armor is made for the whoever they're going to, you know, whoever it is. It's made yeah. per size, so it kind of looks a little big on him, and he doesn't have the whole kit on. He's just really kind of got, because you could see the shoulder blades are just kind of flopping around on him. Yeah. It was not, because it wasn't designed for him, but it was still awesome as hell to see the Boba Fett armor come yeah. back into the show. That was just amazing to me.
It was. And the fact that you could see how weathered it is. I mean, it's got that iconic. It's like, at first you could
dent.
Think. You're
the
like,
dent.
The dent is what set it off. Because yeah. you're like, could this be just something else? And then right. you see the dent and you're like, there's no way. But you see, this is what happens when you get eaten by a Sarlacc.
Well, you know, and that's the thing. Like, going back to, you see Tamura, you see his face is kind of like weathered but scarred. And I think what they did hint that Boba Fett's obviously alive because, A, they've got the armor, all right? Mm-hmm. The Jawas had the armor. But then they say it in the show and that Timothy Olyphant busts up. He's just like, I've never – their Sarlacc pits are never empty. He's like, well, they are if a crate dragon eats it. And so the crate dragon is probably the one that saved Boba Fett's butt. Now, in the expanded universes, Dengar is the one who found him and nursed him back to health. So I'm wondering if we get a Dengar, a cameo or something like that. But if he's still on Tatooine, then it's not following the books, obviously, because they've thrown out all the expanded universe stuff.
Yeah.
But, you know, Dengar and Boba Fett kind of teamed up for a while after he nursed him back to health. But I don't know. I like what the show is doing. And all right, so the speeder bike that Timothy Olyphant was yeah. riding, what do you think he was riding?
He was riding Anakin's old pod. That's what he was. It was one of the engines from Anakin's old pod. It had to be. I mean, the same model, same size, same everything.
Right. Now, another interesting tidbit. I guess let me hit the klaxon again, because, you know, it's one of those spoiler alerts for season 2, episode 1 of The Mandalorian. Spoiler alerts. Was that one of the guys, DJ, my son, was telling me that one of the guys was like the Starkiller guy from The Force Unleashed, that it was the voice actor who actually portrayed him, but they're saying that maybe that was Starkiller. I'm like, no one, I mean, you know how big the universe is? Why would people always be going to Tatooine? It's a freaking dirt ball. Like, why do people go there? So, like, I don't believe that one, but maybe it was the voice actor who just got a little nice little nod in the show. It's like, hey, you want to be in The Mandalorian? No one's going to say, no, why would I want to be in that crappy show?
Everyone I don't want to be in Star Wars. What are you, stupid?
No. I know. Are you crazy? Yeah. So, I don't know. I guess the cool part is now that Boba Fett is maybe coming back in The Mandalorian, there is now talks that there is a Boba Fett spinoff series that's coming into being potentially. That it looks like you got Boba Fett, and I think it's like 2021 or 2021, I think they start filming supposedly. But then there's also other spinoffs that might be happening with Cara Dune from The Mandalorian as well. And it seems like, I'm hoping, because we already know we got the stupid Ben Kenobi thing coming, which honestly, I don't care about that. I really don't care, because yet again, it's going to be set on suck-ass Tatooine. I mean, my God, did they just get a movie? Did they just own Tanzania where they usually film it?
I think that they make money every time Tatooine shows up on screen, and that's why they use it so much. There's some kind of contract or clause or something. When he signed the deal with Satan to get Star Wars, he's like, you have to. Every time, you have to have Tatooine at least once in every film.
But, I mean, I want to see more from The Mandalorian to how they set up the spinoff. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Because I don't know if I want a Boba Fett spinoff. I mean, I don't know if I want one.
I don't think we need it.
The whole part was the mystique of him. And actually, I felt let down a bit when Jango was like, Boba, come here, Boba. You know, and I'm just like, wait, what? And it's like, well, now we know what's under the helmet, you know? And I hated that we found out what was under the damn helmet.
I'm going to go controversial here for a little bit.
Sure you are.
In the original trilogy, What did Boba Fett really do?
Nothing.
He wasn't badass. He did nothing.
He just looked cool.
He got he died by getting something knocked into his jetpack and falling into a pit. That is the most action that that dude did in the entire original trilogy. He was nothing. Dengar was better than him. He had
what?
More.
No, Dengar didn't do
on
squat.
On film, he
Boba
was.
Boba Fett got Han Solo.
Oh, he followed him. That's all he did.
Because nobody else could find him.
He just followed him on his own. That's all he did.
He's the greatest bounty hunter in the world.
He tailed
him. In the galaxy, in the universe. No disintegrations. Whatever. You're just wrong, and it's okay. It's okay to be wrong. I mean, that's just how you roll. But I don't really want to see a Boba Fett spin up. But you know what? If it's set up well and it makes sense, I'm okay with it. Because it's like, I think the Ben Kenobi thing is just getting crammed down our throats. And like, I don't want this crap. Because honestly, it's another way for them to make money. That they're going to find some stupid thing that's going to be like, oh, I saw that in the Obi-Wan show. I'm going to get it. It's like, no. Like, Baby Yoda has just hit the nation in the solar plexus with, aww. And, you know, you're seeing a little bit more from Baby Yoda. He's being more of a character. I don't want to spoil episode two. I'm not going to spoil episode two, so you're safe there. But it's spinoff time. Now, also, in another shocking twist of events, they found an actual Mustafar, Skungy.
An actual Mustafar.
They found a lava planet. There's a planet that has rivers of lava, and it rains rocks. There's nothing but rocks. And so maybe we found Mustafar. Maybe Darth Vader lives there. I don't know.
That places like that actually, obviously you'd think that it would, but the first...
Space, the final frontier. There's a lot out there, okay?
Space scary, yo.
I mean, where do you think they play Among Us? You know, they got to play it somewhere, so they play it around the galaxy. But there is that out there. All right, you know what? Let's get serious real quick. We only got a minute before we got to knock out a break because we went way, way, way too long. But Johnny Depp quit Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. You know, he was playing Grindelwald, and he has hung up his spurs, as it were. And you seem to be very upset by that.
I am very upset. It's kind of like the culture. He lost the civil suit, and that's why they've done this. And they say, Warner Brothers asked him to step down. He didn't step down on his own. They asked him. Yet they're going to have Amber Heard has been confirmed to be in the Snyder Cut for Warner Brothers.
Right.
So it's kind of like, let's not believe him. Let's believe her. I'm not digging this at all. I don't like that at all.
So here's the thing. There's so much money involved that they can't afford, I guess, to upset the base of the film. Now, here's the thing. Honestly, I don't care if Johnny Depp's in it or not, because the movies weren't all that good anyway. They really weren't. I saw them. I was like, oh, yeah, that's cute. You know, the first one was kind of cute. Did I need a second one? No, not really. I didn't need the love story of Grindelwald and the principal, whose name I'm blanking on, Dumbledore.
I didn't need
that. I don't care. But most of the stuff isn't even really based on the books themselves, you know. And a lot of that stuff, while you know, I think people are overly sensitive, the cultural appropriation as far as what they did. I mean, your girl who writes the books, she's not very smart.
Oh my gosh, she's really not
very smart. And she just was like, oh yeah, sure, this makes sense. Read a damn book besides your own, lady. While the movies are nifty and stuff, the whole if Johnny Depp's in it or not, I don't care.
I just think it's a crappy situation and a crappy way to go. That if he wanted to move away, if they wanted to, just the way that they did it,
that's the world of litigation, Skungy.
Yeah,
it's still hanging over his head, and they don't want that involved with their movie. And it's all about getting more butts in the seats, and considering now that there are no seats to put butts in with COVID, they're going to just protect their asses.
And JK has got such a really bad taste in her mouth. They're trying to do anything to bring people because
she just doubles down
dumpster
on stupid
fire.
Stuff. Oh my God. All right, there we go. Let's move on. All right. When we come back, you know what? We'll do another little bit of top nerd news because Ferris Bueller might be back. Star Wars Lego has a holiday special, which actually looks better than the psychedelic 70s version we got. And we got some Assassin's Creed and La Révolution. I binged it this week while I was off, and there are people who people are dumb. Let me just say
people
that.
Just so dumb. People are dumb. You are really dumb.
People are dumb. All right, this is The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Welcome back to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Don't forget, you can listen to previous episodes on the iHeartRadio app at The Week in Geek Radio Show. Here's D Squared.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared, along with
Skungy.
All right, Skungy, before we wrapped up the first segment, we talked about what we're going to talk about in this segment, and yeah. I have no idea why I just kind of, you know, explained all that to everybody. But let's get right into, we have the, so Lego Star Wars, they are doing a special for, what do they call it? Life Day?
Life Day.
But it's basically Christmas. But this trailer is beyond phenomenal. And I'll just leave you with this. Uta tuta solo.
Twas the night before Life Day. In a galaxy far, far away.
Looking good. Tree, food, decorations.
Coming together, heroes were. To celebrate the day.
Please be a cape. Please be a cape.
It's a wrap.
For Rey, adventure call. And she thought it would be fast.
Wow.
But there she found a key to the galaxy's past.
Sorry. Oh, Master Luke.
What are you doing?
This is so cool.
We see my master. My master's master.
Concentrate.
My master's father.
Impressive.
My master's father's master.
Emperor Palpatine? I don't believe it.
You think maybe you could put a shirt on?
It's a key to travel across space and time.
I will change the future.
So sure are you.
Mm-hmm. Less talky-talky, more fighty-fighty.
Pod races.
Geeks. All double geeks.
So cute.
Baby. Ooh, gimme. Galaxy's best emperor.
You thinking what I'm thinking? Music!
A time of joy.
This is...
Ray!
Of friendship. Of family.
Who are you guys?
Master Skywalker.
My son. I mean, my. These binary sons.
Unta unta solos?
You want to shoot first?
After you.
Right there, I take it all back. That is the best line. Instead of less talky talky, more fighty fighty.
Yeah.
Oh. You want to shoot first? Poor Greedo, man. No. He gets shot twice now, and then he gets shot by both Solos. So if you didn't catch the gist of it, it's all a time travel thing, which looks really funny. Then it's like my son. Those binary sons.
It looks so much fun. I mean, Lego has always done a really great job of being very tongue-in-cheek, very
when they
lighthearted.
Finally let them start talking,
yes.
When they gave them voices as opposed to and just grunting. Remember the original Lego Batmans? It was just grunting. And then you got, not Will Ferrell. Who's the guy who
Will Arnett.
Will Arnett, right, yeah.
It looks so much fun, and the fact that most kids that know Star Wars have no idea about the original holiday special.
No, and it should stay that way.
Yeah,
it should
stay that way.
Honestly, I feel like we talk about it way too much. We're not helping anybody by constantly picking at that scab.
Look, what we're doing is we're getting money to royalties to Be Authors Foundation.
Oh, sure. Yeah,
that's what we're doing.
Let's do that. We'll do that. All right. So that's coming out November 11th,
I believe?
17th. Okay. All right. So moving on. Ferris Bueller.
Bueller?
They're talking about a sequel, not a reboot. If they reboot Ferris Bueller, I will pull a Jay and Bob, get on a damn plane, and fly out there and just beat the snot out of everybody who tries to reboot Ferris Bueller.
Agreed.
But they want to do a sequel, and it's your boy
Cameron.
So he's posited this idea, and I think it's hysterical because Cameron in an old folks' home sounds just like him, and he'd probably be dying every day. You know, I could just see him. You'd go into like the old folks' home, and there he is with all these things. Beep, beep, and he's got the IVs and everything. I'm dying, Ferris. Like, you've been dying since high school, dude. And he breaks them out, and then hilarity and hijinks ensue. And I think that would be awesome because Matthew Broderick is still awesome as hell. And, you know, I like the new commercial that Cameron did for the whatever that stupid garage door opener, which got a camera.
Yeah.
He's like, dude, bow, bow. Don't even think about it. So, you know, look, you got to strike when the iron's hot. When people remember your stuff, do it.
The
you know?
Iron's hot?
Well, I mean,
it's been 30 years.
I know, but that commercial and then just you know, him showing up again, people like, oh, and look, they've been banking on it on our nostalgia for like a decade now because they can't come up with anything new. But if one of the original people from the original movie wants to do something that's not a reboot but a continuation, because you have to address the fact that they're old farts now. You have to address that fact.
Well, Alan Ruck seems 100% behind it, who is the guy who played Cameron, so.
Well, look. Get it? Get her done. Get her done. All right, moving on. Spider-Man. I guess it was like a month or so ago, Skungy, where we talked about what the new sequel is going to be, or the third installment, because you had Homecoming, Far From Home, and I kept saying I knew it was some derivation of the home stuff. So word is on the street from a guy named Guido. He told me that he heard it from somebody from Atlanta who worked at one of the construction companies that built stuff in Los Angeles, and then they went up to Quebec, and then when they came back to Los Angeles, then they went over to Hollywood, they're saying it's called Homesick.
Homesick.
Now, I might have misunderstood. The guy said he's been all over the country, and maybe he was homesick? I don't know, but it makes more sense to me that it would be called Homesick because he's on the lam because they accuse him of killing Rey Mysterio. Oh, wait, no, that's the wrestler.
Yes, it was Rey Mysterio.
It was Rey Mysterio. And so he's, you know, on the lam. He can't go home. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's been off planet for a while. Tony Stark died. They're keeping everything going on. You got this multiverse, which if Doctor Strange comes out before that, we'll have a better grasp of what the multiverse is. But considering we have confirmation, we've talked about this before on the show about Electro
Fox.
Coming back, Jamie Foxx with Electro, and the other, Andrew Garfield and
Tobey Maguire
coming back, where the multiverse will be there, but. So if he's going all over to other multiverses, he would be homesick, and I'll bet my left nut.
You heard it here first, folks. All right, I will get the saw and whatnot ready because he might be wrong, in case.
I'm not wrong because I'm never wrong. You know what I'm right about? Assassin's Creed is working on an animated series. They're also working on a live action series
as well.
We had that live-action movie with Magneto.
I didn't even watch it.
Good.
I didn't.
You
know
saved
what?
Yourself 2 hours of just like...
As much as I love the series, as much as I love that series,
They tried to make it too much like the movie, but then they wanted to put these weird things in it where it just wasn't the same. Mm. And it's really hard. That's why they're video games, because sometimes it's really hard to translate those into a movie that makes sense, and people always want to do different things with that. All right, but I will say this though: one thing about the games, though, I like how they go through all these different worlds and histories and different nations' histories and stuff like that, with a world history interconnecting it. That would be cool, but I mean, does it have to be Assassin's Creed? I mean, I guess you could slap the Assassin's Creed and just have Templars versus Assassins. I don't know, maybe I'd want to see more of that, kind of like...
I guess the reason why they're doing it is because you have the unique stand in Assassin's Creed where you're both in modern time and you're in a machine that's reliving the memories of an ancestor. So you can, and it's going to be an anime style, so you can have that kind of futuristic, I don't know, Ghost in the Shell kind of feel to it.
Yeah, maybe so. I mean, I don't know. I think there's potential there. But after the movie, and how many movies have we seen based on video games that have just been giant turd burglars?
Look at the works of Uwe Boll, if you want to see some crap.
Oh, my God. How is this man... stopping, moving on. All right, but Assassin's Creed, I guess my segue into the next segment or the next topic is, you know, Assassin's Creed Unity, and when they were set in
garbage game, but yes.
Right, but it was set in revolutionary France.
Yeah.
And so La Révolution, it's a Netflix series. I binged it this week while I was on vacation, and I liked it. I really, really liked it. And what set me off was that I was looking at IO9 on the sci-fi's, you know, written word website. And this person just went off and just said, oh, how dare you gloss over the terror and the mass executions and death that happened in the French Revolution. And their title was, how dare you make a show about, you know, rah-rah nationalism for the French people and gloss over all the death? I'm like, bro, so when you watch the trailer, it looks like it's going to be a period piece about the French Revolution. Because the trailer doesn't give you a whole lot except some nice, pretty pictures of the nobles partying and peasants peasanting, okay? And that's what
Are they revolting?
They're not revolting yet.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and so When I first started watching episode one, I didn't know exactly what I was getting into. But then they had some weird monster thing eat some little girl. And I'm like, okay, that's weird. And then let me do this. Spoiler alert for La Révolution on Netflix. Okay, there's 8 episodes. It's spoken originally in French, but it's dubbed and it's subtitled, okay. So you don't have to speak French. I patted myself on the back several times because I could read all the little news clippings and stuff because I speak French. Now, what I liked about the show was that it was an alternate history, kind of in the vein, but not completely, but like a Abraham Lincoln vampire hunter or Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies. What this show did was kind of lure you in with the spectacle and the world of the French Revolution during that time, but the pièce de résistance, is that these nobles are eating people. But why are they eating people? Because they're immortal, because they have blue blood. They're infected with some sort of disease. The blue bloods have blue blood, okay? And the doctor, and I didn't catch this initially, his name is Guillotine. Uh-huh. So doctor, okay. The guy actually existed in French history, and he did not invent the guillotine. He just said it would be better and more humane for all the mass executions they had to do. It was more efficient, but also more humane. You can put me down for the guillotine. I'd be fine with that. Don't electrocute my ass. Yeah. That would suck. No gas chamber. But I digress. So the people who are knocking the series are saying that they're glossing over the horror and terror that was the French Revolution. Well, what they're doing is, and this is the best part, is that they're not really – it's a series. So episode one ends, you know, or season one ends not really on a cliffhanger, but you're wanting more because – it starts in one little French province where the French Revolution starts to grow. But it's not a revolution. What they're doing is they're defending themselves from the aristocracy. They're now infected. They can't be killed except by what, Skungy? Decapitation. The guillotine. You've got the peasants attacking the aristocracy because they are now immortal. And not only are they celebrating and eating cake while the peasants are dying in the streets, they're now eating the damn peasants. And so it's this kick-ass version where the French Revolution wasn't exactly for in this world that they've created. Isn't about, you know, human decency and human rights. It's about
cannibalism.
These bastards are going to eat us. We got to chop off their heads, and we need an efficient way to do it. So people who crap on stuff, like we go back to the opening of the show with people crapping on the Mando. Enjoy things for what they freaking are. Not everything has a political agenda, for the love of Christ on his cross. Sorry, that I love Jesus, but God. Oh, my God. So this show is awesome. And like, I want to watch The Barbarians. But and from my understanding, that is a period piece. Like the Romans speak Latin, the Germanic tribes speak German. It's dubbed and subtitled. But it is more of a realistic thing where it's it was made in Germany, so they're showing the, you know, the Germanic tribes kind of, you know, fighting off the big man that is the you know, the Imperial Rome. Yeah. Obviously, they lose that war. Yeah. But great, nice little area. But this La Révolution has nothing to do with real life. It's this funny, weird little take that the Blue Bloods are trying to eat the peasants. Nice. Okay, so apparently they're not revolting. They don't stink on ice because they eat them. Oh my god! All right, let's end on a high note.
That wasn't a high note.
That was a good high note. You know what? We are way over time. You know what? Let's leave it on a high note. All right, this is The Week in Geek. When we come back, we'll talk with Jeremy Piven. His new movie is My Dad's Christmas Date, in theaters and on demand now. Jeremy Piven next, and then we'll wrap up the show with Skungy's Pick of the Week. What is it, Skungy?
It's Watch Dogs Legion.
Legions?
Legion.
Like scratches on a poor doggy?
Not legions, Legion.
Oh, for we are many.
Yes.
All right, this is The Week in Geek on News Talk, 99.5 WRNO.
This is The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Like them on Facebook and follow them on Twitter at Twig Radio. Do it now.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. So earlier in the week, I had the joy of talking to one Jeremy Piven, and his phone kind of broke up in the old school question section, but that was it. Otherwise, it was awesome, and we opened up with, here, listen to this god-awful song. Let's go to the guest line. Jeremy Piven, Ari Gold from Entourage, Dean Pritchard, old school, and my personal favorite, Draws from PCU. Jeremy Piven joins the star of the new film, My Dad's Christmas Date. Jeremy, how you doing today, buddy?
Good. How are you, my friend?
I am doing well, man. I'm getting some little afternoon delights going right now. I don't know why people hate this song so much, dude. I just don't get it. I don't understand the hate.
You know what? I don't think it's hate. I think that song is more funny than good, and I don't know if we need comedy in our music. Does that make sense?
It does, but I'm a jackass sometimes. I do a lot of the satirical music. Like I take songs and then redo words to them, a la Weird Al kind of stuff, because I don't know. That's how
there
I jam.
There you go.
So, Jeremy, look, let's talk about your new movie, My Dad's Christmas Date. I got to an advanced screening of it, and let me just say, it's really cool, man. It's got this cute, you know, but serious premise, though, and it's not just your average Christmas fluff, man. So tell me about it.
It isn't at all. It's kind of wrapped up in this movie where you think it's going to be one of these kind of holiday feel-good movies, and then you realize, well, wait a minute. You got a dad that lost his wife. He's mourning. The daughter is kind of spinning out as well. She feels sorry for the old man, puts him on these online dating services, and suddenly he's on dates that he didn't know he was on. So it's a really funny, fertile, comedic premise. And I love making it. And listen, we all need a good laugh right now.
Amen. One of the things that I thought about was just that, you know, like, it was really funny with the dates, her not, letting, you know, setting you all up and stuff. But then, I mean, really, like, you're an amazing actor, dude. You were just, the tears were flowing, man. I mean, and that, I think that was one of the cooler parts about the movie was this, that it was very funny, but then it did get very serious. And so, bravo, sir.
Well, thank you, man. That's kind of what we live for as actors, is to kind of play real human beings that experience what we experience in this life. And our lives are just comedy. Sometimes it gets tragic. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, so it's all these different things. So, you know, sometimes people can get used to seeing you in one way. And now, you know, I get to play a real human being, and it was an honor. And by the way, it couldn't come at a better time. We're all sitting around trying not to infect each other and trying to figure out who's going to be president. So I think we need an escape. And I'm honored to provide one.
You know, wait, did they film Harry Potter there? Because it looked like there was a lot of Harry Potter scenes where you filmed the movie.
You know, we filmed it in York, which is one of these towns outside of London, a couple hours outside of London, that is one of the oldest towns on the planet. You know, it's like in America, we have some strip malls that are almost 30 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Well, imagine imagine these towns that have been around not just for hundreds of years, but you know, Roman influences and castles, and it was a magical place to shoot in, and it was perfect. You know what? They might have even written this comedy for this town, because that's the type of fit I felt like it was.
So now I got to ask you a question. Is Dean Pritchard basically draws all grown up from PCU and then go to old school? Did he sell out and become Dean Pritchard? Is that what happened?
You know, there is a thread there. But you know what? There's nothing premeditated about these characters. You mentioned old school. I would have loved to have played any of those roles. Don't get scripts until Vince Vaughn and Will Ferrell are cast. So right. What's left? Well, their nerdy friend who they locked in a dumpster. Well, let me audition for that. Can I audition for the nerdy? But you don't, Jeremy, you're not nerdy. I know, but I can play it. You know, there you have it.
So, look, I know you're a Bears fan. I'm a Saints fan, and I'm sorry, but is this your jam from back in the day? Looking for trouble. I just came to do the Super Bowl show. I can imagine you as a youngster just jamming out to this. Did you, Jeremy? Tell me the truth, man.
Of course. Are you kidding me? That's the 85 Bears. we never forget, and we're looking for the next one. The Saints are always competitive, and you gotta love Drew Brees. He's a stud. He's a total legend, and I love New Orleans. But yeah, I do love my Bears, and you know, listen, this year's crazy. Tom Brady is 43 years old, and he could lead his team to the promised land. We don't know.
Yeah, it is terrifying, man. I mean, it's just like the dude does not age. But this will be an interesting season, man. I mean, your Bears are doing great. The Saints are finally kind of picking up slack. Our defense sucks, but whatever. But you know what? Maybe we'll see each other again, a la 2006 NFC Championship. You know, we go head-to-head, and then we'll get back together. I'll tweet you, and we'll make a bet, buddy.
Count me in, my man. And don't forget to watch my movie, because we need to laugh right now.
Amen to that. My Dad's Christmas Date is out now. Jeremy Piven, one quick question before I let you go. Ari spinoff, Ari Gold, is it ever going to happen, man?
You know, you never know. You never say never. But, you know, people keep asking me that. So at a certain point, someone has to realize that people haven't forgotten about these characters and they want to see them again. So
exactly.
I don't know, man. Let's see.
We'll will it into existence. That is Jeremy Piven, new movie, My Dad's Christmas Date, out now. Jeremy, thank you so much for your time today, brother. I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you, buddy.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Strutting our stuff for everyone. We're not here to
start no trouble. We're just here to do the Super Bowl show. All right, coming up next, Skungy's Pick of the Week. This is The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Hey, you Ninja Turtle fans, this is Raphael. That's right, the OG Raphael. And the only show we listen to here in the sewer while eating our favorite pizza is The Week in Geek on WRNO Radio. Fighting power!
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared, along with...
Skungy.
Now, Skungy, that was... Rob Paulson.
Rob Paulson.
Oh, my God. Ooh, I suck at this job. Rob Paulson, he will be our guest next Sunday.
Are you sure this time?
I'm really not sure. I'm very discombobulated right now. They just say, come here, do a show, and talk for an hour. And I'm like, okay. She hates these cans. Stay away from these cans.
Squirrel.
Now, as always, we want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website at twigradio.com. Follow us on Twitter at twigradio and the Instagram's The Week in Geek. Now, Skungy, how can people listen to this lovely show?
Well, if you missed any part of tonight's show or you want to hear your favorite part again, you can always find us on Spreaker.com, or you can download Spreaker for your smartphone or tablet. You can also find us on iTunes, YouTube, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify,
and your mama's house.
iHeart Radio.
Skungy's Pick of the Week.
I am not what you would call a handsome man.
I love lamp.
Skungy's Pick of the Week.
You might be an idiot savant.
Woohoo! You might be a guy who can't carry a tune in a bucket. Skungy, what's your pick this week?
I've got a wheelbarrow, sir. So, Watch Dogs Legion is the pick of the week.
Okay, DJ's played that game. I haven't gotten around to it. That's the like you're hacking stuff?
Yeah, so this is the third game in the series.
Okay.
Now, Watch Dogs is about you play a hacker, and it's an open-world third-person game that you can go around and you can... Basically, they have drones around. You can use... You can rob banks.
I know he spent more time accessorizing his outfit with his hoodies, because apparently there's lots of hoodies, and the kids love hoodies
these
days.
Yes, they do.
So I'm gonna create a game called Hoodie, the game.
You would probably make a lot of money
probably.
Off of that. This one is really cool because, number one, I really like the Watch Dogs series. The first one was a little too serious for my taste.
Okay.
The second one was very tongue-in-cheek, very fun, very lighthearted. The premise of this game is there's an organization called DedSec who are hacker...
DedSec. Okay.
They're a hacker organization, and they are blamed with bombings throughout London where... And it's a very scary type of story because it's about giving up personal privacy for security.
Oh, that's like the Ben Franklin quote.
Yes.
You know, he who gives up liberty deserves neither.
Yeah, so what happens after this bombings in London, this organization gets blamed, and this new organization comes in and goes, we're going to protect you, we're going to... But it was them all along
that set it up. The government? We're here to help.
Exactly. So, I'll tell you, the main thing about this game that's unique, and it's the one thing they've talked about the entire running up of it, you can recruit any single NPC in this game to your crew.
Wait, what?
Any character that is walking down the street. And I tried it out, and it's true. When you pull up your phone, and your phone is your hacking tool.
Right, right.
And you'll highlight a person. Now, you can do different things like I said, you can hack doors, you can hack security cameras and everything. But if you go on a person, you'll see that person's name, what their occupation is, a little thing about them, and then their personal skills.
Really?
For instance, some people might be good at melee combat, so they're stronger at melee. They can take less physical damage. Some of them hack stuff faster. Some of them start with certain weapons that are more advantageous.
So can I go find an old granny that is really good at melee skills? I would make my life's work to find the little old granny with the walker who's got a high melee skill.
I don't know about their melee skills, but you do find an old lady who is a former assassin.
Ooh, nice.
All right. And some of these...
Hi, Mama. Can I have some cookies with a side of death?
Some of them are so... I mean, it's so useless for some of them, but you go around trying to find somebody who's going to be best suited. So when you play through, there is no main protagonist in this game. Like, you're playing this character. You're playing this entire organization of characters.
The nebulous them.
So when you go on a mission, you're going to sit there and go, this recruit is going to be better suited doing this type of mission because I need to go and beat people up. Or this one has got a sniper ability and it's going to be better.
Ah, cool.
You can recruit, and it literally says, vagrant. is their occupation. And one of their skills, I'm not joking, is begging for money.
Nice.
Is a skill that they have that you can do.
Hey, look, you know, if you've got it, flaunt it.
And every person has a story arc. And a mission. You have to do a mission in order to recruit them. There's something that they're going, like some
organization. This almost sounds like Fallout. It's got Fallout level
far more action to it, less of the RPG
okay.
to it, because that's one interesting thing. It does not have a level up system.
So you can discard useless NPCs. It's like, hey, Granny, your melee skill is too low. I'm going to go find an older old biddy who can actually hit.
You can
hit.
Do stuff like that, but you're not going to get an upgrade like experience points. What okay. you do is you'll find tech points scattered throughout the land,
right.
and you can use those to upgrade your tech and your upgrades. But not your character itself. So you can make your spider bot. You have a little spider bot that runs around. Or you can make it where it can jump higher or have a lethal kill. Active camouflage. Wow. Stuff like this. And you upgrade that. So that is one of the coolest things about it. So you're not worried about trying to level up that character. Another cool thing this game does is fast travel. Now, a lot of games...
Is it as fast as The Witcher or Elder Scrolls? What was the one that's... They actually upgraded it to make it actually faster.
Exactly. This one's really cool because most Ubisoft games, when you go and you find a fast travel... You have to actually go find a fast travel point and unlock that point, and it's like you have activated fast travel here. As you're driving through London, if you pass by one of the underground stations, that's automatically opened up for fast travel. So you can be driving just down the street to a mission, and you can unlock like five fast travels.
Oh, okay. All right. I get
so
I get
it makes it so much easier for that. Oh, my God. I'll tell you one thing that I've done. People drive on the wrong side of the road.
What do you
in
mean?
This game.
We drive on.
No, they're on the wrong side of the road, and I've gotten in more accidents in this game because they're driving on the wrong side of the road.
Yeah, it takes some acclimatization or acclimatization. None of those words are real.
And so the campaign's about 40 hours long if you try to do everything. This game does add one cool thing to it.
What?
Called permadeath. Now, you can turn it off if you want to, but... If you say you go through and you find that perfect recruit, you're like, this guy's perfect. I need him for everything. I'm going to use him a lot. He dies, that's it. Bye-bye. So long. He ain't coming back.
Wow.
So you can turn that off if you want to, but it does kind of give you a little bit of a risk-reward to it.
No, not Fritz.
Now, there
Fritz,
are some parts...
Back to me.
There are some parts that are just absolute bullcrap. So I was in...
Wow,
I was,
such language, potty mouth.
I was in a van, and I'm driving to a mission, and I clip a barrel. The barrel explodes. My guy's gone.
Well, hey, man, learn how to drive, dude.
Once again, the barrel was on the wrong side of the road.
No, you've already stated that you already were having problems with the driving. So, look, obviously the problem is with you and not London.
True. And everybody
but why do they have explosive barrels around town?
Just because they're causing explosions all over town, remember? So.
Oh, I get it. Okay, so I'm going to say if, like, you know, the Interstate Bureau, whatever the hell they're called. There's like, hey, you know what? For fun, let's put some exploding barrels out on the highway. Just see what happens.
Instead of the water barrels to sit there and stop you and help you, it's going to blow you up a little bit.
Some will be liquid nitrogen or something.
And going on with the whole theme of like security and everything, they have cameras all over the city.
Okay.
So you wear a mask. To hide your identity. So, yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun.
All right, so price and platform.
So, this game is going to be, it's $59.99 for the regular edition. There are a couple of different versions that are $100 that come with the season pass and whatnot. Ubisoft always does that.
Yeah.
It is on the Xbox One, the PlayStation 4. It's also on the Series X and the PlayStation 5.
Ooh, so this is like one of the first.
This is going to be
not
smart
first, but
delivery,
yeah.
as they call it, for the PlayStation, where you just buy the Xbox. You buy the Xbox disc, and it automatically upgrades.
Oh, well, fancy schmancy. How about that? All right, before we wrap up tonight's show, we lost two great people over the course of the week. Last week, we lost Sean Connery. And, yeah, it's been 2020 is the year that keeps giving. And today we lost Alex Trebek. You know, and because I can't take anything seriously, Celebrity Jeopardy in Heaven is probably going to be a lot of fun now.
It is.
Because all the quote-unquote, air-quote, original characters are now up there, right? We lost
Burt Reynolds.
We lost Burt Reynolds.
And
what was his name? Turd Ferguson?
Turd Ferguson.
We lost Turd Ferguson.
Yeah.
Now we lost Sean Connery and your mother, Trebek.
Your mother.
We lost Alex Trebek. Man, I was so happy because like he had beaten it for a while and was cancer-free, but then it came back. And, you know, man, what do you do?
What do you do? 2020 sucks.
So who was the third person? It was Trebek, Turd Ferguson, And it was like a nobody, huh? Or wasn't it? I can't remember.
No, it wasn't a nobody. Oh, Jerry Lewis. Jerry Lewis was on the original. It was the original.
Oh, God, really?
Those three were on the original episode of Celebrity Jeopardy.
All right, well, there you go. All right, we got to get out of here. We went long, and we really have no time because the show is now over. So, once again, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio and the Instagram, TheWeekInGeek. Till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high. Rob Paulson next week, too.
Get News Talk 99.5 WRNO FM New Orleans anywhere on our free iHeart Radio app.